ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितमेन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. मुखं करोति वचलं पङ्गुं लङ्गायते गिरं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारिणं वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. नमामो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेस्थाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनितनाम्ने नमस्ते सरस्वतीदेवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे जय श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवसादि गौरभक्तवृन्द. हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे. So we are continuing to read from Brahma Samhita. We are in the part 2 of Brahma Samhita, which is the prayers of Lord Brahma, called as the Govindam prayers. And today we will be doing verses 40 to 42, and today is class number 15. So in the previous few sessions, the past 2-3 sessions, we have actually seen about Bhava Bhakti. And then in the very next class, we saw about Prema Bhakti, about the devotees who are in the Prema Bhakti. Especially we discussed about Srimati Radharani and her sakis, who are her bodily expansions. And then after that, we saw this verse, Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena, how these devotees actually in this highest stage of love of God, they perceive Krishna, how they are able to see Krishna. So that we discussed. And then after that, we went through the previous verse, which is Ramadi Murtishu, where we saw how Krishna is the source of all incarnations, and he is the source of both Rama, he is also the source of Narsimha and others who are considered to be very complete incarnations, because often we have Lord Ramachandra actually is a very, very complete incarnation, but still Krishna is considered most complete, and how Krishna is the source of even the other incarnations. So we read a little bit from Laghu Bhagavatamrita, where Rupa Goswami discusses this in detail about how Krishna is actually the source, and we saw the case of Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, and then how they took birth as Ramana Kumbhakarna, and then later how they were finally liberated when they came as Sishupala and Dantavakra. And Rupa Goswami takes this case, and he goes on to discuss that in detail, and then he goes through an entire process of proving how Krishna is the source of everything. So that's what we did till last class. So in the previous set of verses, actually, till verse number 38, it was mostly talking about Bhava Bhakti, Prema Bhakti, how a person perceives Krishna in such a stage. The very next set, starting from verses 39, actually just 39 we covered previous class. So 39 to 42 is going to discuss about how Krishna is the source of everything. Krishna is actually the source of everything. Just in verse number 39, we saw Krishna is the source of all incarnations. Now, in today's verses, that is verses 40 through 42, we are going to see how Krishna is the source of the Brahman, the impersonal Brahman. Then we are going to see how Krishna is the source of the material creations, and how Krishna is the source and the basis of all the rasa that is there in both the spiritual and the material world. So this set of verses, that is 39 to 42, talks about how Krishna is the source and he is the basis of everything. So we have just done already 39, where we saw Krishna as the source of all incarnations in our previous class. So from today's class, we'll see what else Krishna is the source of. So verse number 40, we'll read verse number 40, where it discusses about Krishna being the source of the Brahman and the basis of the impersonal Brahman, and then we'll go on.
Yasya prabha prabhavato jagadanda koti koti svasesha vishudhati vibhuti binnam tat brahma nishkalam anantam asesha bhutam govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
Verse 540, synonyms.
Yasya, of whom? Prabha, the effulgence, prabhavitaha, of one who excels in power, jagadanda, of universes, koti kotishu, in millions and millions, asesha, unlimited, vasudhadi, with planets and other manifestations, vibhuti, with opulences, bhinnam, becoming variegated, tat, that, brahma, brahman, nishkalam, without parts, anantam, unlimited, asesha bhutam, being complete, govindam, govinda, avipurusham, the original person, tam, him, aham, I, bhajami, worship. Translation. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, whose effulgence is the source of the non-differentiated Brahman mentioned in the Upanishads, being differentiated from the infinity of glories of the mundane universe, appears as the indivisible, infinite, limitless truth. Purport. The mundane universe created by Maya is one of the infinite external manifestations accommodating space, time, and gross things. The impersonal aspect of Godhead, the non-differentiated Brahman, is far above this principle of mundane creation. But even the non-differentiated Brahman is only the external effulgence emanating from the boundary wall of the transcendental realm of Vaikuntha, displaying the quadrantial glory of Govinda. The non-differentiated Brahman is indivisible, hence is also one without a second, and is the infinite and residual entity. So, this verse talks, is actually a very important verse. It's a very famous verse, and it's often quoted by our acharyas to show that Brahman is actually the effulgence of the Lord or the bodily race of Krishna. Now, if you see, the verse itself says that it is the effulgence of Krishna. But in the purport, you also see that the same Brahman is also described as the effulgence from the boundary of Vaikuntha. Sometimes Brahman is also considered as the effulgence from the spiritual world. Sometimes it's considered as the effulgence from the toenail of Radharani, sometimes the toenail of Krishna, like that. But overall, in general, we understand that Brahman is the effulgence of the Supreme Truth or the Supreme Person who is Krishna. Actually, his bodily effulgence or the effulgence from the Supreme Abode, the Vaikuntha or the Goloka, is actually considered as the impersonal Brahman. And Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, he also states and he confirms this. He says, Brahmano hi pratishtaham. So I am the basis of the impersonal Brahman. Actually, if we read the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam or the Krishna book, there is the story of how Arjuna and Krishna, they pass through the Brahma Jyoti. Actually, they are going in search of the sons of the Brahmana when the sons of the Brahmana were suddenly missing. So there is the story that is discussed and how Arjuna and Krishna are actually traveling out of the universe and they actually go and they meet Mahavishnu is actually the story. But when they are going to meet Vishnu, on the way they actually pass through the impersonal Brahman or the Brahman effulgence, which is considered as the light. So at that time, Bhagavatam says that Arjuna couldn't keep his eyes open, and because he's not able to even open his eyes, it's so blinding, it is so bright, that light, that effulgence is so bright that Arjuna just couldn't keep his eyes open. And at that time, Krishna actually confirms, "Oh Arjuna, these are actually my race, my effulgence." So, though the Bhagavatam doesn't openly make the statement the way I said it, still, if you read the purport, actually, there are some verses that is quoted from Harivamsha, Harivamsha Purana. It is one of the it's an extension of the Mahabharata. The last part is called as Harivamsha Purana. There, this journey by Lord Krishna and Arjuna to Vaikuntha is narrated in Harivamsha, where the Lord tells Arjuna these following statements. He says, Brahma Tejo Mayam Divyam Mahatya Drishtavanasi Ahamsa Bharata Sreshta Mat Tejas Tat Sanatam. My divine expanse of Brahman effulgence you have seen is none other than myself, O best of the Bharatas. It is my own eternal effulgence. This is the translation. Then Krishna continues to say, Prakriti Sa Mama Para Vyakta Yakta Sanatani Tam pravishya bhavantita mukta yoga vid uttama. It comprises my eternal spiritual energy, both manifest and unmanifest. The foremost yoga experts of this world enter with it and become liberated. Then, sa sankhyanam gatihi partha yoginam cha tapasvinam tat paramparamam brahma sarvam vibhajate jagat mamaivam atad Ghanam Tejo Nyatum Arhasi Bharata. It is the supreme goal of the fellow followers of Sankhya, O Partha, as well as that of the yogis and the ascetics. It is the supreme absolute truth manifesting the varieties of the entire created cosmos. You should understand this Brahma Jyoti, O Bharata, to be my concentrated personal effulgence. So these are some statements by Krishna in the Harivamsa Purana, where the same pastime of Krishna passing through Brahma Jyoti as it is described in Bhagavatam is also described in Harivamsa Purana. And there Krishna makes these statements. And if we go through the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, where you see this particular verse, you will see the entire thing is quoted by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, and Prabhupada has written this in the purport of one of the verses. He writes the entire thing down, all these verses that I just read. So the Brahma Jyoti is actually located outside Vaikuntha, beyond the material world. So it is sometimes even referred as Siddhaloka, or even in some cases it is referred as Brahmaloka. But still one should not confuse this Brahmaloka to be the Satyaloka, which is the abode of Lord Brahma. Sometimes even Satyaloka is called as Brahmaloka, sometimes even the Brahma Jyoti is called as Brahmaloka. So depending on the context, we should understand what is being said. So these are the different names for Brahma Jyoti, like Siddhaloka, Brahmaloka, all these are different names. So the essential nature is that it is spiritual. Brahma Jyoti is spiritual, but still it has no variety. It is just like a homogeneous sunshine. So Krishna is like the sun and the sunshine is like Brahman. So depending on one's vision, one either just sees only up till the Brahman, or some people are able to see beyond this impersonal Brahman, and when they see beyond this impersonal Brahman, they actually see Bhagavan. So we have this famous verse in Srimad Bhagavatam, Vadanti Tat Tattva Vidas. So that talks about the three features, the Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan. So depending on a person's level of realization, different levels of the Supreme Absolute Truth is revealed. So however, this formless Brahma Jyoti is actually not the original source, because something formless cannot create a form. So it's like simple logic. Something form, doesn't have a form, how can it create something that has form? Like in the material universe, you're seeing things with form, you're seeing things without form also. Like we human beings, we have forms. Any trees have form. So many things that we have constructed in this material world has form. Everything around us has form. So if we are all from that original Supreme Person, how can that original Supreme Person not have a form? So it's a simple logic. Now one may say, okay, there are so many formless things here too. Yes, the air is formless in the material world. That is true, because the Supreme Absolute Truth also has the formless feature, which is the Brahma Jyoti. But at the same time, we should understand that the original source is always the person who has a form. So that is something that is discussed in this verse. And this original person is actually the basis of the impersonal Brahma Jyoti. So the light is the potency, and the potency depends on the potent. Krishna is the potent, and his potency is actually the Brahma Jyoti, which is the light. So there are actually many examples of people who are Brahman realized and who later become Krishna conscious. So like for example, in Bhagavatam itself, it discusses the cases of Sukadev Goswami, the four Kumaras. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, if you read, you will see the case of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. He was a very, very serious impersonalist, and by the grace of Sriman Mahaprabhu, he actually became a devotee of Krishna. So basically, this Brahman understanding is more like a beginning stage of realization of God. But as you progress, you understand that God is actually a person. So in the Bhagavad Gita, So as far as, I mean, we are just saying, yeah, it is better, you know, it's a better understanding to know that Krishna has a form and, or rather God has a form and all that. But Krishna also confirms this in the Bhagavad Gita, saying which is better, which kind of realization is better, whether the impersonal realization is better or the personal realization is better. So in Bhagavad Gita, chapter 12, if you see the first few verses, it's kind of interesting. It goes like this, Bhagavad Gita 12:1, Arjuna inquired, which are considered to be more perfect, those who are always properly engaged in your devotional service or those who worship the impersonal Brahman, the unmanifested? The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, those who fix their minds on personal form and are always engaged in worshipping me with great and transcendental faith are considered by me to be most perfect. This is verse number 2. 12.3 and 4 Bhagavad Gita, it says, but those who fully worship the unmanifested, that which lies beyond the perception of the senses, the all-pervading, inconceivable, unchanging, fixed and immovable, the impersonal conception of the absolute truth, by controlling the various senses and being equally disposed to everyone, such persons engaged in the welfare of all, at last achieve me. For those whose minds are attached to the unmanifested, impersonal feature of the Supreme, advancement is very troublesome. To make progress in that discipline is always difficult for those who are embodied. But those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me and being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service and always meditating upon me, having fixed their minds upon me, O son of Partha, O son of Pritha, for them I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death. Just fix your mind upon me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and engage all your intelligence in me. Thus, you will live in me always without a doubt. So these are the words of Krishna, where Arjuna is asking him, which is actually a better realization. And Krishna gives this answer, saying that it is good. Yes, impersonal realization is good, but it's very troublesome. And ultimately, over a period of time, they all attain me. So understanding me in my personal feature as the Supreme Personality of Godhead is actually the best, and you should know this without any doubt. So these are some words from Krishna telling us that the personal realization is actually the topmost. And even in Ishopanishad, actually, this is another famous verse that is often quoted by our Acharyas, Ishopanishad 16. It says, O my Lord, O primeval philosopher, maintainer of the universe, O regulating principle, destination of the pure devotees, well-wisher of the progenitors of mankind, please remove the effulgence of your transcendental rays so that I can see your form of bliss. You are the eternal Supreme Personality of Godhead, like unto the sun, as am I. So Krishna is glowing, but the devotees who have the eye of devotion see through this effulgence, and then they are able to see the form of Krishna. Just like in the previous class, we discussed this Premanjana Charita verse, where we see that if your eye is tinged with a love of devotion, a salve of love, you can really see Krishna. You can see the form of Krishna. So happiness from this Brahma Jyoti, attaining this Brahman, the state of liberation where you merge into Brahman, that is compared to be like the water contained in a hoof print of a calf. This is described by Rupa Goswami. But whereas happiness in serving Krishna is like an ocean. The happiness received is like an ocean. So it's a nice statement, but you see, actually, this same statement is actually proved again and again by some devotees. Like, for example, this verdict is given by Hanuman, where he says, actually, if you're going to give me liberation, if liberation means I have to give up the service of Lord Ram, I don't want any kind of liberation. I don't want any liberation. So Hanuman is a person who's giving this verdict where he says that service to a personal form is better rather than just getting some kind of an impersonal liberation where you don't have any active service to perform. And also Krishna, he very, very rarely grants devotional service. Actually getting impersonal liberation is quite easy, though they go through a tough process. Still, Krishna is ready to give impersonal liberation to many people. Like for example, the demons easily achieve impersonal liberation. This is a common statement. But to get love of God, to grant devotional service, that is very rare. Why? Because Krishna himself becomes controlled by the devotee's love and Krishna gives up his independence. So this is the greatest and the most wonderful quality of the Lord. The Lord is so great and the greatest of all is ready to get controlled. So he doesn't give it so easily. He gives it to devotees. But if we have if the devotees have love for Krishna, that means that something they have achieved is very, very rare. Actually, Krishna is trying to show that he is getting controlled by the devotee. That means he is saying the devotee is greater than me. Just imagine, devotee becomes greater than God. So Krishna is ready to take that position of being being sold out to the devotee. So this is something very rare. So the person, and an example of that, and a person who really exercises maximum control over Krishna, Srimati Radharani. So actually, if you see, a devotee is stronger than Krishna, and the strongest of everybody is Srimati Radharani, because she actually controls Krishna to the maximum extent. So actually, she's the strongest of everybody, because she is able to control Krishna. Krishna takes that position where he becomes subordinate to his devotee. So that's why devotional service is very, very rare. It's very rare and it's a very precious thing for everybody. There's another interesting fact that has been reiterated again and again by Prabhupada, and also it is there in Brihad Bhagavatamrita. It's confirmed in Brihad Bhagavatamrita about the color of Brahma Jyoti and the color of the sky that we are seeing in this material world. Actually, the spiritual sky is supposed to be blue. Brahma Jyoti is supposed to be bluish in color, bluish shining light it is. It's not exactly pure white. It is actually bluish because Krishna's bodily hue is blue. So if it is emanating from, if it is the light rays emanating from Krishna's, or if it is called as Krishna's bodily effulgence, then it has to be bluish in color. So the Brahma Jyoti is supposed to be blue in color, and also the sky that we perceive in this material world, that is also bluish, because it is the same reflection of that Brahma Jyoti. The reflection of the Brahma Jyoti is what we actually see as the sky. Of course, in science, we learn all kinds of things. Like, I think in high school, we learned something like it's the reflection of the ocean or something, that we see that the sky is actually transparent or colorless, but we see it as blue because it is a reflection of ocean. So something, I don't know if I'm even right. I remember vaguely in school days, we learned something like this. But actually, no, according to Shastra, it says that it is a perverted reflection of the Brahma Jyoti. That's why the sky looks blue. And actually everything comes, even the light of the sun is actually the light that is borrowed from the Brahma Jyoti. So like that, the color of Brahma Jyoti and the color of the sky is discussed. And this Brahman is actually all-pervading. I wanted to read this verse from Brihad Bhagavatamrita, confirming what we just stated. This is the verse, Brihad Bhagavatamrita 3.7.82. It says, Brahman is all-pervading and eternal, the greatest sky, Maha Akasha, is Parabrahman, the Supreme Person Krishna with his dense dark blue effulgence. This is the verse that the Acharyas quote to say that Brahma Jyoti is also bluish. So that is about this verse, verse number 40, that talks about Brahman effulgence and how our Acharyas, they always use this as one of their favorite verses to show that actually this Brahman comes from the effulgence of the Lord. Next, 41.
Maya hi yasya jagadanda shatani sute traigunya tat vishaya veda vitamayana vitayamana sattvavalambi parasattvam vishuddha sattvam govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
Maya, the external potency, he, indeed, yasya, of whom, jagadanda, of universes, shatani, hundreds, sute, brings forth, trigunya, embodying the threefold mundane qualities, tat, of that, vishaya, the subject matter, veda, the Vedic knowledge, vitayamana, diffusing, sattva avalambi, the support of all existence, parasattvam, the ultimate entity, vishuddha sattvam, the absolute substantial principle, govindam, govinda, adipurusham, the original person, tam, him, aham, I, bhajami, worship. Translation. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who is the absolute substantial principle, being the ultimate entity in the form of the support of all existence, whose external potency embodies the threefold mundane qualities, which is sattva, rajas and tamas, and diffuses the Vedic knowledge regarding the mundane world. Purport. The active mundane quality of rajas brings forth or generates all mundane entities. The quality of sattva, mundane manifestive principle, in conjunction with rajas, stands for the maintenance of the existence of entities that are so produced, and the quality of tamas represents the principle of destruction. The substantive principle, which is mixed with the threefold mundane qualities, is mundane, while the unmixed substance is transcendental. The quality of external existence is the principle of absolute entity. The person whose proper form abides in that essence is alone unalloyed entity, non-mundane, super-mundane, and free from all mundane quality. His cognitive bliss, it is the deluding energy who has elaborated the regulative knowledge, Vedas, bearing the threefold mundane quality. I don't know if anyone understood anything, but we'll elaborate a bit on this. So basically, in the beginning of the class, I was telling that the theme of today's session, right from verse 39 to 42, is that Krishna is the source of everything. So in verse number 39, which was Ramadi Murtishu, we saw how Krishna is the source of all incarnations. And in the verse that we just discussed, we saw how Krishna is the source of the impersonal Brahman. So in this verse, we are seeing how Krishna is actually the source of sattva, rajas and tamoguna. He's the source of everything, or he's the source of the Vedas, or he's the source of the material creation. Because this verse, it talks about Maya. It talks about how Krishna is actually the source of the material creation. So if you see the phrase that is used, it says substantive principle, being the ultimate entity in the form of the support of all existence. That means this is Vishuddha Sattva. Krishna state is not he doesn't take up Sattva Guna or Rajo Guna or Tamo Guna. Krishna is always in the state of Vishuddha Sattva. So Vishuddha Sattva is the principle, and this person Krishna is Parasattva, and this person, he supports all of the existence, both the spiritual world as well as he supports the existence in the material world. So what is this Vishuddha Sattva? That means it's pure goodness. We have heard many times, right? So Krishna is actually in this principle, he's in this state of pure goodness, or the spiritual world is in the state of pure goodness. Now this Vishuddha Sattva, it comprises of the three potencies, the three internal potencies. You must have heard these internal potencies several times. Sandini, Samvit and Hladini. So these three are actually the internal potency of the Lord, and when these three are together, it is called as Vishuddha Sattva. So Sandini, what does that potency do? Sandini, it actually sustains the existence in the kingdom of God. Sandini potency actually sustains everything in the spiritual world. So that energy is called as Sandini energy. We have heard that this is actually controlled by Lord Balaram. So he controls the Sandini potency. And this Sandini potency is the manifestation of Sat. Sat means, like we have heard, right? Sat, Chit, Ananda. These are the qualities, eternal, blissful, cognitive bliss. We have heard this phrase several times, Sat, Chit, Ananda. So the Sat is nothing but the Sandini energy. And this energy actually sustains the entire kingdom of God. Then the Samvat energy is the energy of consciousness, and it is externally manifested as Chit, cognizance, right? So that also comes from the internal energy of the Lord. It's called as the Samvit energy. And then we have Hladini. Hladini is the potency that manifests bliss. Externally, it is known as Ananda. And actually, Radharani is called as the Hladini potency because she gives bliss. So the three together are called as Vishuddha Sattva. When Sandini, Samvit and Hladini together, which is all the internal energy, different forms of the internal energy, they are together they are called as Vishuddha Sattva. So when this Vishuddha Sattva is manifest with the Sandini potency predominating, see, Vishuddha means, the state of Vishuddha means everything is mixed together, okay? In this mixture, when Sandini potency is predominant, that thing sustains the kingdom of God. When Vishuddha Sattva plus Samvit potency predominates, it manifests as transcendental knowledge. When Vishuddha Sattva is manifest with predominance of Ladini Shakti, it is called as love of God, or the bliss or the ananda that is received when one performs devotional service. So all these are manifestations of Vishuddha Sattva. Now the perverted reflections of these three actually comes as the three modes of material nature in the material world. The perverted reflection of Sandini, Samvit and Ladini actually turns out to be the Sattva Guna, Raja Guna and Tamo Guna in the material world. That is what actually the purport was trying to say. So the perverted reflection of Sandini is called as goodness. The perverted reflection of Samvit is the Tamo Guna. Whatever is intelligence, if it's perverted, it's tamas, right? Like it's obviously Tamo Guna. Now perverted reflection of Ladini Shakti is Rajo Guna, passion. Passion comes out as a perverted reflection of Ladini Shakti. A perverted reflection of Sandini Shakti, that which sustains, actually turns out to be goodness in the material world. So these are the three things. So when pure goodness or Vishuddha Sattva becomes mixed, it becomes the material energy. And when it is free of these modes, it is actually the spiritual energy. Okay. Now, the last part of the purport, and also the last part of the verse, it talks about how the modes of nature diffuse the Vedic knowledge. That was very interesting, actually. If you see the Vedas, actually, the Vedas, as we know, the four Vedas, they deal mostly with these three modes of material nature. They deal with desires from passion and ignorance, if you look at the Vedas. So in fact, even in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Traigunya Vishayo Veda, Nishtraigunya Bhavarchana. That means these Vedas, they actually contain these things. The three modes of material nature is actually diffused through the Vedas. The Vedas are also containing these three modes and encouraging people in the mode of passion and ignorance to actually make an advancement in Krishna consciousness. So that's what this verse says. And everything is actually coming from Krishna. And how it comes out from Krishna is actually this Vishuddha Sattva principle that is there in the spiritual world. When it gets contaminated or when it becomes perverted in the material world, it shows up as these three gunas and it is seen in the material world. So the same Krishna is also the basis of who is the basis of the spiritual world is also the basis of this material world. And he sends out his teaching through the mode of Vedas. The Vedas are diffused with these three modes. So this is a synopsis of what this verse says. Now we'll go to verse number 42.
Ananda chinmaya rasatmataya manashu yat praninam pratipalan smaratam upetya lila yitena bhuvanani jayati ajasram Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Ananda, blissful, Chitmaya, cognitive, Rasa of Rasa, Atmataya, due to being the entity, Manashu, in the minds, Ya, he who, Praninam of living entities, Pratiphalan being reflected, Smaratam upetya, recollecting, lila yitena, by pastimes, bhuvanani, the mundane world, jayati, triumphantly dominates, ajashram, ever, govindam, govinda, adipurusham, the original person, tam him, aham I, bhajami, worship. Translation, I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, whose glory ever triumphantly dominates the mundane world by the activity of his own pastimes, being reflected in the mind of recollecting souls as the transcendental entity of ever blissful cognitive rasa. The keyword here is whose glory is triumphantly dominates the mundane world by the activity of his own pastimes being reflected in the mind of recollecting souls as the transcendental entity of ever blissful cognitive rasa. So his activities triumphantly dominating, and these are recollected in the minds of all the souls as so that is what this verse is saying, how people are thinking, or the smaranam of Krishna's pastimes is seen in the world. Purport. Those who constantly recollect in accordance with spiritual instructions the name, figure, attributes and pastimes of the form of Krishna appearing in the amorous rasa, whose loveliness vanquishes the god of mundane love, conqueror of all mundane hearts, are alone meditators of Krishna. Krishna, who is full of pastimes, always manifests himself with his realm only in the pure receptive cognition of such persons. The pastimes of that manifested divine realm triumphantly dominates in every way all the majesty and beauty of the mundane world. So this is what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati says. Now, if you see the beginning of this verse, it starts off, with this thing, Ananda Chinmaya Rasat. So this part is actually very similar to verse number 36. 36 also starts with the same phrase. And this verse goes on to say that the same Krishna, who is the source of all incarnations, who is the source of Brahma Jyoti, who is the source of Maya or this material creation and the three modes of material nature that is seen in the material world, the same person Krishna is also the source of all the rasas. It says, whose glory ever triumphantly dominates the mundane world by the activity of his own pastimes. So all his pastimes, like killing the demons, subduing the pride of Indra, killing Kamsa, subduing the pride of Kaliya, everywhere Krishna dominates alone. And by smaratam, that is by the remembrance of these pastimes without any speculation, if we hear it as it is and we keep remembering it again and again, all these leelas of the leela purushottam, leela itam, when you start meditating on that, Krishna actually becomes manifest. We go through the stages of nama rupa guna leela. So that's what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj, he says in this purport, as to how the whole thing is revealed, nama, rupa, guna, leela, everything becomes revealed to the devotees. Actually, especially here, the mood of the conjugal love is actually highlighted. And actually, we see the exact purport. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati goes on to say, the people who are in this amorous rasa, they alone are actually the pure meditators of Krishna, because they are meditating on the highest rasa of Krishna. But anyway, this applies to everything. It of course applies to everything. So actually, that's why when we chant, we actually just focus on the name, hearing the name. We don't try to start artificially meditating on the pastimes of the Lord. Even when you chant, the focus is given on hearing. That's in fact, today's class also, morning class on everyday chant was that only. Bhaktivinoda Prabhu also spoke about the same thing today morning. So what we do is when we chant the holy names of the Lord, we actually hear the name. That is most important. We just have to focus on the holy names. So people who meditate on the name, as you meditate on the name, we can slowly, from the name comes the realization of the form. That is, you will see that the form of Krishna is actually embodied in the name. As we purely, it doesn't happen in a day or two, but as we keep attentively hearing and we chant the names of Krishna, we come to the realization that the form of the Lord is actually embodied in his name. Then within the form, actually slowly, including the personality of Krishna, is manifest the qualities of Krishna. From nama we understand rupa, from rupa we understand guna, and they themselves demonstrate the pastimes of Krishna. From nama, rupa, from rupa, guna, from guna, we go to leela. So all this it happens automatically when you start chanting over a period of time. As you chant purely, you will start to realize the form of Krishna. Then you start to understand the qualities of Krishna. Then you enter the pastimes of Krishna just by chanting attentively and hearing your chanting. So this name, this nama that is given to us is like an ocean. The form is like waves, the qualities are like small waves, and the pastimes are the interaction between the waves in the ocean. So all of this, the Rupa Guna Leela, is actually manifest within the name. So this is actually an example that I think it was given by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. The name is like an ocean, the form are like waves, the qualities are like small waves, and the pastimes are like interaction between the waves in the ocean, and everything is found within this name. So that's why the name of Krishna is so precious in this world. Another example is given is a flower bud. The flower bud is like the name, and as the flower bud begins to open up, it takes up a form. So this form is compared to the form of Krishna. As it opens up, a fragrance is emanated. This fragrance is compared to the guna that manifests over a period of time, the gunas of Krishna or qualities. And then when the bud fully blooms, actually it is compared to the pastimes of Krishna. So just like a little bud that is blooming, the same way the bud is like the name. You start with nama, then you go to Rupa Guna Leela. So all this flows automatically. But however, when we chant, we are not recommended to meditate in the wrong way, like trying to meditate on particular pastimes, especially the amorous pastimes and all that, without understanding the philosophy properly or without doing devotional service properly. If we try to do that, then it is called as the Sahaja mentality. So we have to go in a step-by-step process. So everything is there in the name, actually. Once we get the name right, the rest will fall in place. That's why in the Brihad Naradiya Purana, this is one of the favorite verses of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, said, Hare Nama Eva Kevalam Kalo Nasteva Nasteva Gati Anyata. So he always recited this verse from Brihad Naradiya Purana because his teachings was that, just take the name, the name will reveal everything. And you can always remember Krishna. The smaratam of Krishna will be automatic if you just take the name. So that's why even Draupadi, she chose to call out the name of Krishna. She's a very good example for everyone to follow. She called, Hey Krishna Govinda. So like that, automatically when you take the name in a pure state, the rest will follow. Krishna consciousness is also, the basis of Krishna consciousness is chanting the holy names. So that was about this verse. So actually we'll stop here for today, and if you have any additions or any corrections, anything to ask, please go ahead. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Very nice class. I had just a thought. When you were speaking about nama, rupa, guna, lila. And you were talking about, so lila is the pastimes of the Lord. And you're talking about the verse, I believe it was 42, the one about that the pastimes of the Lord are within the minds of the devotees, more or less. What was that verse you just, which one was that?
Yes, Mataji, you're right.
Which can you tell me that again one more time? Which verse that was? 42?
Yeah.
Okay. So I was, and then you were speaking about how the Sladhani, Samvit, and Sandhani sect energies are the are the unperverted reflections, like the pure reflections of Vishuddha Sattva. I was just thinking that. I guess maybe to expand on that further. So as we are, how they say, how Srila Prabhupada is talking about you can spiritualize the material things, like spiritualize the flower by offering it to Krishna, that idea. I was just thinking in that same kind of broader terms that as these devotees are using the nama, rupa guna, getting to the lila, talking about that lila and being immersed in that lila, that's how they have changed that that rajastamo guna, you know, maya shakti into the visuddha sattva shakti. So they're spiritualizing that. Does that make sense, Diosha? I'm thinking.
That's so beautiful, Mataji. So beautiful.
So anyway, so I was just thinking how, and that's, I mean, it's very step by step. It's not kind of vague. It's almost like he's very clearly stating the process.
Yeah.
Of how this actually happens. And the fact that, like you were saying, we are just supposed to focus on the nama. It's like Srila Prabhupada is giving us the actual the catalyst. I don't know if it's the catalyst word, that actually starts that process, which is just chanting the name. You chant the name, you go through the whole other process, you get to this point where you're smaranam of the Lord and his lilas, and then that maya sakti changes into the visuddha sattva and spiritual energy of the Lord.
So beautiful. So beautiful. Thank you, Mata.
Thank you.
Haribol.
Haribol Mataji. Thank you for the wonderful class.
Haribol.
I have one question. Mataji, you were mentioning about the light of Brahmajyoti seen by, did you say Arjuna or Krishna and Arjuna, or what was the story that you were
Prabhu, they go to retrieve the sons of the Brahmana who has been taken away by Vishnu and Lakshmi, and these children are playing in Vaikuntha, or rather you can say it should be either, it doesn't clearly say it is the spiritual world, but what happens is they actually travel through the different universes, and then they get out of the Brahma's egg, and this thing, and then they get into, they actually hit the Brahmajyoti, and then they go into the Viraja. So that is the path that they take. So when they hit the Brahmajyoti, at that time, Arjuna, he's not able to see, like he closes his eyes, it's so bright, the Brahmajyoti. That's when Krishna begins to speak, explaining to him what this light is.
Okay. And in which canto can we find that, Mataji?
In the 10th canto, I think it's the last but one chapter of the 10th canto. It should be around, I think there are 80 chapters, right, 10th canto? Let me just quickly look. I think it is 80. So it should be around the 79th chapter or something, where the story is discussed about how Arjuna and Krishna, they go. Let me open up 10th canto. So 10th canto, 89, chapter 89, Krishna and Arjuna retrieve the Brahmana sons. If you read that chapter, the story is very interesting, and in one particular verse, there is this purport by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur that quotes Harivamsha Purana.
Okay. Thank you so much. That was very good. I'll refer to that.
Haribol, Prabhu.
Haribol, wonderful class. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Wonderful class once again. Like everyone is saying, amazing class. I actually remembered once about, you were talking about the color of the material sky and the color of the the jyoti, right? So I remembered when we were going to in temple before the Sunday program begins, Balabhadrapu was giving a Bhagavad Gita class. In that, this statement that he made kind of made a very good impression on me that I wouldn't forget. Like, he made similar statement that he was saying that this material science or the modern science, it says that the sky is blue because of so-and-so, some RBG, red, blue, and green were major colors, and apparently so the particles in sky happen to reflect blue or something.
Now
the question, the correct question would be, how the sky is blue, this is the answer. If you were to ask a question, how the sky is blue, this is the scientific answer that you can give. But it will not be the answer for why the sky is blue. Of all the things, why should blue reflect, start reflecting? Any, there are so many colors, right? Any other thing also can reflect. Why should blue have the wavelength that matches the reflection capability, kind of a thing? So that's where the spiritual knowledge comes in place, and he went on explaining further. So that kind of really made me understand how much value we should give to the spiritual knowledge, rather than, you know, thinking that this material knowledge itself is more than enough for us, kind of a thing.
So nice. I didn't know this was the material, even the material answer also, I didn't know. So thanks for saying.
Yeah, that's the thing. I think that's what physics says, so yeah.
Oh, wow. So nice. So cool, Prabhu. This was interesting.
Thank you, Prabhu. Wonderful.
I don't even know. Maybe in primary school or something, when this question, somebody told me it's the reflection of the ocean.
Yeah, I mean, I think as this is an evolving syllabus, right? I think 1 year you will teach something, then next year for another 5 years you teach something else in place of that.
Correct. Oh, wow. Nice, Prabhu. Thanks for sharing that. That is so impressive, right? The way he said, so why should it be blue?
Yeah. So very good. Yeah.
Hare Krishna, Matai. Renda Krishna, Matai.
Hari Bol, Prabhu.
As usual, I mean, so nice, Matai. I really enjoyed, Matai. But I was running here and there for shopping because some devotees are coming home, Matai, today.
Oh, yay.
Yeah. So, from Houston only, Matai. Some devotees are coming. So,
nice.
Then, when you were talking about the color, right, Matai, I remembered in my childhood, we always used to listen to Vishnu Sahasranama, right? Here in Japan also, they mentioned the color of sky is blue, Shantakaram Bhujagasai, you know. You remember, Matai?
Yeah, I remember.
It goes like Shantakaram Bhujagasai, you know, Padmanabham Suresham, Vishwadharam, for the whole universe, right? Vishwadharam, Gagana Shadesham, Megavarnam. It's a blue. Megavarnam Shubhaga. I mean, if somebody is not convinced with our things, we can ask them to refer back to
Vishnu, sir.
Which they know. I mean,
amazing, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu, for saying that. Yeah, that
when we get doubts, we have to refer many places, right, Matai. So it's one of the things they can refer. It's not something misconstructed. So,
super, Prabhu. Thank you. That is also very true. Vishnu, I mean, like, even I was even thinking, like, you said Vishnu Sahasranamam, like how it says Megavarnam Shubhangam. So nice. Even like the word Vishnu means also all pervasive, right? I don't know if that's. Yeah, so that's blue. And he's also blue color, so the sky is blue. So nice. Thanks.
I have no questions, Madhavi. Thank you so much for the class.
Yeah,
really
thank you.
Week by week, Madhavi. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hari Bol.
Hari Bol, Madhavi.
Hari Bol, Madhavi.
Hari Bol, Revati.
So much for the wonderful class, Madhavi. I don't have any questions, Madhavi, but the class was really good, Madhavi. Very nice.
Thank you so much, Revati, Madhavi. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Okay, so then we can end the call.
Sure.
Prabhu?
Not me, Mate. Revati Mate is here, sure.
Okay. No.
Yeah, we resemble the same voice.
Vancha Kalpatra. Yeah, Kripa Sindhu Vyayavacha Patitanam
Pavati
Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai Namachar Shila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai Shri Shri Brahma Samhita Ki Jai
Priti Mataji Ki Jai
Anant Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai Hari Bol.